And for Hot Copy this morning, we continue to know your senatorial candidates. With us, we have Lutgardo Barbo, who is running under the ticket of the PDP Laban's Pacquiao wing. Good morning to you, Mr. Barbo.
Good morning, Karen. See you again. Yesterday, I saw you in person.
All right. Yeah. Okay. Well, Mr. Barbo, you are running for a Senate seat, but not many of our viewers know exactly who you are, what your track record is. So let's give them a brief history. You were a Senate. Let's talk about your Senate experience. You were Senate Secretary twice. That's correct. Yeah. And you are also a professor of the Ateneo University. Go ahead, yes. Sir.
And I used to be a governor of my province for three consecutive terms. Mm-hmm. I'm a teacher. I'm a lawyer. I'm a human rights lawyer. And incidentally, Marcos put me to jail by ASO, arrest and seizure order. But we got compensated. But that's about all I can say.
Okay. All right. So, Mr. Barbo, let's start with this. You served as Senate Secretary in previous Congresses, and you did that twice. Is that one of the reasons that encouraged you to actually run for the Senate? One would think that's too ambitious. Others would say that you could have started. Well, you were, of course, governor for three terms. Let's not forget that. But what made you decide to seek a Senate seat?
Well, like you said, I used to be the Senate Secretary for two terms during the Senate presidencies of Father and Son, Nene and Coco, and especially during the impeachment trial of Irap Estrada. And I think that was the first time I saw you. You were interviewing Nene Pimentel. I am not that ambitious, but as a professor in the Ateneo School of Government, I teach governance, understanding the bureaucracy. I have been doing that for more than a dozen years. Modesty aside, I know the job of a senator. Again, modesty aside, I do not intend only to win a Senate seat. I would like to be an outstanding senator. Mm-hmm. And I have several bills and even resolutions to file the day after I am sworn into office.
Now, you were a three-term governor in Eastern Samar from 1988 to 1998. So 2 years after the Cory administration, you became governor of Eastern Samar. Why didn't you run for local office after 1998?
Well, I was appointed or selected by the Senate as the Senate Secretary, unanimously elected. And I remember it was even Kit Tatad who nominated me. And Raul, the famous Raul, Senator Raul, used to kid me that if he did not know me, he would have objected. But he endorsed me. Yeah. Raul Rojo. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Okay. So I was with you in yesterday's campaign as I trailed Senator Manny Pacquiao. And you, in your speeches, evidently really focused on the Marcoses or the candidacy of presidential aspirant Bongbong Marcos. And would you say in a way that it resonates with your own personal history that you were arrested during the Marcos time?
You know, Karen, it's not only my arrest and detention that they goaded me to run. I know that the Marcoses have a lot to answer. I was in New York when Juby Solonga asked me to join him. That was 1986 or 87. And I know that Ferdinand Marcos is William Saunders, and Jane Ryan is Imelda. And I know how the stashed away so much wealth in offshore banks. And I remember Rene Sagisak, who was there also. And I told him, I said, Rene, how is it that there is no evidence about the plunder of Marcos? And jokingly or seriously, Rene told me, and he said, you will have to dig into the records and to the documents. Do not be lazy in reading. Remember, Marcos was not only intelligent, he was brilliant. And so he would want to cover up with paper trail and documents the way he stole money from you and me and from the Filipinos. And true enough, I learned a lot about how Marcos plundered this country and made it appear that this is not for their own good, but for the good of the country and the Filipinos. And I don't like that. As a teacher, as a professor, and as a parent, I think that is wrong, because a good leader must show the way, lead the way, and go all out of the way, and should serve as some kind of an example. And I think Bongbong will not be a good example. I can't understand why he says, join me because we are going to have a unity team. What kind of unity is that? Is that a unity to forget the plunder? Is that a unity that would say, forget our errors of judgment, our money-making ventures? Forget all about it and let's be united. I think that's wrong. Unity should be based on a good rationale. It should be justified, and it should be based on truth and justice.
So you are a professor and you teach this to your students. May I ask, what subject do you teach in Ateneo, sir?
Yes, I have been teaching governance, public governance. I have been teaching also understanding the bureaucracy, and at one time I was also teaching law and public policy.
Okay,
so and I always encourage my students to speak out their minds, because I always remember Nene Pimentel, who said, speak out your mind before it is too late. I asked him not to be contented what we see around, what our leaders are doing, what the government is regarded, how it is regarded by Filipinos. And there are many Filipinos who are pathetic, who are cynical about the way government is being run. I am getting to be disappointed. And I think we have to change, and change for all the good that it should redound to us. We need good governance. Otherwise, just like I was in the provincial government when I was awarded the highest award of the Lingkod Bayan Award, I was saying that to some extent there is a basis of the new People's Army to be rebelling, to be rebels against the government. And I remember Nene Pimentel saying that the NPA is not the problem. The NPA is a problem, meaning it's only one of the problems.
Okay, because, let's focus. Mr. Barbo, in yesterday's campaign in Baseco, I was there with you and I saw
you. I know, I saw you there.
Yes, and you essentially, as I said, you focused your campaign speech on an anti-Marcos platform. But how do you explain it? You just talked about the plunder right now. And yet, Mr. Marcos is frankly leading by a mile with the CDE market, or I would say the socioeconomic classes belonging to the CDE. What does that say to you?
Well, the fact that he is leading in the service does not make it right. Meaning, what they did to this country does not justify it. Perhaps many are just blinded. Many are not aware of the real issues. For example, when I was incarcerated via ASO, arrest, search, and seizure order, practically there was no reason for that. Just because I was associated with Joby Salonga, and this even said I was associated with Steve Sinakis, and that's not true. And they said I was a member of the Light the Fire movement, and that's not true. I never was. I never was associated with them. But when the ASO was served on me, it was signed by Marcos himself. Of course, I think it was a Xerox copy, and Defense Secretary Enrile had it enforced on us. At the time, I was the personnel manager and legal counsel of the multinational American company in San Fernando, Pampanga. And that is where they picked me up. And I know, who picked me up. His name is Robert Bayuna.
Okay, but do you believe that kind of injustice? It is now, so the argument of supporters now is it's 2022. It's time to move forward. Do you believe that kind of injustice may still happen under a Marcos leadership today? What if it becomes a story of redemption, of change, of trying to prove good governance? I'm just trying to be balanced here.
Yes, correct. I'd love that to happen, but the redemption should be based on justice. At the very least, they should say, our apologies. We are sorry. We made your lives uncomfortable and inconvenient, and some got lost somewhere and never to be found. And many were incarcerated without any basis at all. And we took your money, and we made good out of it. And in fact, we are running, and we're spending that money we took away from you. Perhaps that would be a good way of saying, let's unite. We are sorry. We have made mistake, just like everyone, human beings we are, we make mistake. And so okay, forgive us.
But frankly speaking, in admitting we took your money, that's not a mistake. That would be an admission of a crime.
Well, perhaps they might want to admit it, but perhaps they can say, well, some people say that we took your money because there are documents that would prove that in the Supreme Court. Just forget about it and let's move on. And after all, we are going to use this money for the welfare of Filipinos, something like that.
Okay.
But the bottom line is apologize and tell people that the Philippines was not the golden, at the time, it was not the golden era and not a Singapore-like or on the way to Singapore. Singapore's example, you know, do not mislead people. A good leader should not mislead people and should be honest.
You believe that's what Mr. Marcos is doing today in his campaign?
I don't think he is doing it right. Why is he shying away from you or from other journalists who would like to interview him? Why would he not attend debates? Why would he not appear? Why would he want to appear only in Quiboloy? Is it because Quiboloy has been endorsing him? That's unfair. He should show that he is the correct leader and the good man to lead this country. Nobody can lead this country if that leader is deemed to be a liar and a thief. And I cannot understand, Karen, I used to be president of two big universities. I was president of the Philippine Normal University for 4 years. I was president of Taguig City University for 3 years. And I know that the mere act of falsifying records, will disqualify you from getting to be appointed as a member of the faculty. Or if you are a member of the faculty, you can be dismissed outright. And if you are applying for a job, and I interview you, and we find out that you are falsifying some of your records, you are blacklisted. You cannot.
So, Kevin, so what do you think is happening? I mean, clearly, you have a. This is based on experience. You have the track record for it, given you are a professor and you headed two schools at one point. What do you think is happening if to you it's clear that he should have been disqualified? Why is this going on?
Something is wrong with our political mentality. Just because he has a name, but that name should be a good, reputable name. I can't understand why people would say we are for this man, and he is a convicted criminal. He is judicially documented and recorded as a convicted felon. And yet we rally behind him. He would want us to rally behind him so that we can be united. My God, Karen, unity should be based on justice and truth.
So it seems to me that your campaign, your personal advocacy, is really to educate or inform people about the Marcoses. This is what you do when you go out and campaign.
Correct. Okay. I am basically a teacher and a lawyer. I teach people.
All right. But then what about, let's face it, do you believe that would be effective? I mean, are you out there to win, or really the advocacy to educate is stronger for you?
Karen, I have been asked that question, but I would rather be right than elected. I think it is a job of a public official to educate people. Part and parcel of the function of a good leader is to enlighten people, to educate them, because education, like Rizal said, is the only kind of salvation and redemption that we can have. Otherwise, traditional politicians would want the electorate, including you and me, to get ignorant about the issues, so that perhaps with open palm, we would be ready to receive some bribe money. But that is not, a good, enlightened, educated electorate, I think, is the key to good governance.
There's a good question here. Why didn't you speak up when Mr. Marcos actually won a Senate seat, or even when he was running for vice president? Why today?
I have always been speaking against the policy and the behavior of Ferdinand Marcos Sr. And I did not believe that Ferdinand Jr. was doing good as a senator. I think people should know that there is more cosmetic objectives in his being senator. And may I tell you this, Karen, when I was a governor, Ferdinand Marcos Jr. went to me in the office in Borongan, Eastern Samar.
Okay.
And I was surprised. I was surprised why he came to see me there. Yeah.
Okay. All right. I think we need to move on from your anti-Marcos advocacy, as I can see. But clearly, this is a major platform for you while you campaign. And I've witnessed it yesterday as well. But the question is, what will you do in the Senate? Because Mr. Marcos doesn't attack his opponents. Mm-hmm. And studies have shown it's actually become an advantage for Mr. Marcos that he does not attack his opponents. He does not do negative campaigning. I'm citing studies, okay? So what would you do if you win as senator?
I'm going to do something, several in fact. Number one, I would like to give meaning and substance to the constitutional provision that says, and that is Article 2, Section 26. It says, the state shall guarantee equal access to public service and prohibit political dynasties as may be defined by law. Number one, I would like to have a level playing ground. Hindi tama na mga mayayaman lang ang pwedeng mag-billboard, magkaroon ng TV advertisement. Equal access to opportunities to public service. Hindi pwedeng sabihin na ang mayayaman lang ang pwede maging public officials. Maraming mga magagaling na mga kulang sa pera at walang pangalan. Ibig sabihin, hindi yung kanilang mga apelyido ay hindi sikat. At sila lang palagi ang nanalo. And now, I think something is wrong with that. And that is why I have to give meaning and substance to that provision of the Constitution. And number two, the Constitution prohibits political dynasty. But, here is the but. That should be defined by law, meaning by Congress. Mm-hmm. I would like to define what this political dynasty is, sort of animal. What is it? What is that kind? So we will have to define that. That is one. In fact, the first day after taking my oath as a senator, I am ready to file that because I have records. I have researched on this, and I am ready to have it filed the first day when I am elected as senator. Another thing, you know, yung sa AMLAC, ano yun eh, yung accounts natin, that is voluntary. I would like to make it compulsory so that if you are a public official, your accounts, if there are good reasons for that, should be open. Mm-hmm. And we should authorize that by law. That's number one. Number three, I think COCs, the certificates of candidacy, should be accompanied by the SALED, the Statement of Assets and Liabilities.
Okay. That's quite reasonable. That's mm-hmm. Yeah, that's very yeah. Good.
And I would like also to outlaw political turncoatism. Karen, it's not good na ikaw ay mayor, nanalo yung iba yung partido mo, nanalo yung presidente mo. Baliktarin lahat, baliktaran. Political parties are the basis of good governance because political parties serve as some kind of guidepost in managing the affairs of the nation. Kung ikaw ay mayor o ikaw ay governor o ikaw okay. Ay senador o congressman, mawawala ang posisyon mo pag ikaw ay nag-turncoat. Mm-hmm. Kailangan okay. You have to stick to your political
party. Now, clearly you're quite idealistic with some of the things that you want to pursue and legislate if you do win a Senate seat. You've been witness and you've lived at a time of Jovito Salonga, the late Senator Nene Pimentel, yeah. Rene Sagisag.
Yeah, my political idols.
Absolutely. And you're seeing the Senate today, wherein, sadly speaking, you do have some legislators who take the seat for granted, aren't very active, are either absent too much, and more than that, you have the Senate that will be, if they do win, will have four families in the Senate, right? So you do have that.
You said it right.
Sibling, mother and son. That's what the Senate has become.
You said it right. Correct. And the Senate has much, something much to be desired, you know. That is perhaps one of the difficult things when invariably you would compare the past Senate and the present Senate.
Yeah.
A Senate that was responsive and responsible and to a lackadaisical Senate that we have today.
Mm-mm.
We should have a vibrant Senate because the Senate, just like the House, is codependent, or you know what we call the so-called, we should exercise what so-called the checks and balances. When, for example, the executive department is simply abusive and using cash words, somebody should stand up in the halls of the Senate and say, enough is enough. You have signed the good manners and right conduct. You yourself should be guided by that law.
Mm-mm. So, Mr. Marbo, there's no question that you are respected as a professor. I even have right now Professor Edna Ko from the UP Public Administration saying, you're a colleague at the Ateneo School of Government. You're a man of integrity and professional, your profession. And it's focused only on you now because you are running for a seat. But should you be running for a Senate seat, or frankly, should you have put up an advocacy group on good governance? There are many ways to educate people, and it's not necessarily to run for office.
Correct. When I was governor and when I was a human rights lawyer, I was always advocating something. Mm-hmm. And that is why perhaps they locked me up and told me I was a member of the Light a Fire movement, because I was saying that you do not have the right to endure and to put people in jail, especially if they are innocent. Mm-hmm. I have been fighting for that, and I had to suffer for that. But my consolation is that the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, former Chief Justice,
it's all right. Yeah. Okay. Go on.
I was given that kind of distinction for standing up to abuses and fighting for human rights. T. Hanke, in one of the decisions in a case which I won in the Supreme Court, said that Attorney Lutz Barbo is hereby commended by this court for his unrelenting and fearless advocacy for truth and justice. It is now in the Supreme Court reports annotated.
Okay.
So, and I intend to do that. Even if I am not a senator or governor.
Okay, Mr. Barbo, so if you don't win a Senate seat, what would you do?
Perhaps I will continue teaching. I have been asked by the Ateneo School of Government to go ahead with teaching. But the problem is with my eyesight, because it's going to be, you know, long distance learning. I have to focus on the monitor. But if my eyesight improves, then perhaps I can go back to the classroom, the face-to-face one, because I usually ask repeated questions whenever I ask my students to recite.
All right. If your candidate, presidential aspirant Manny Pacquiao, doesn't make it, who do you believe should be, I guess, who would be a good president for the country?
I have always said this time and again, Karen. Lenny Robredo is a good choice. If Manny Pacquiao were not a candidate, and if he were not with my party, because he is the president, I am the executive vice president and vice chair of the PDP Laban, I have to support him. But if he were not running, I would support Lenny.
Okay.
I think she will make good decisions as a president.
Would you advise Senator Manny Pacquiao at one point to withdraw and support the vice president?
Number one, I cannot do that because withdrawal is a personal matter. It is on his part. But I think it is not in the nature of Manny Pacquiao to just say, I throw in the towel and say, I give way. Remember, Manny Pacquiao is a fighter in and out of the ring. And more than that, I believe in Pacquiao because He's fighting for you and me. He's fighting for righteousness. He's fighting for the lowly people that we not forget. We only remember them during elections. He's fighting for the depressed and people who are already apathetic and indifferent to our government.
All right. Well, Mr. Barbo, thank you so much for joining me today. Is there anything you'd like to add to those watching who are seeing you for the first time, probably, and now discovering that you are running for a Senate seat?
I am going to humbly tell people who are listening and watching me that I will make good in the Senate, that I will not disappoint you. I will do the best I can. If I won the highest award given by the Civil Service Commission, which is the Lincoln Bayan Presidential Award, I might not get that award, but you will see me in the Senate halls or in decision hall fighting for you, for the rights of Filipinos, and to make this good this government have good governance, because we need good governance if we have to move and move forward. That's the only way, because corruption should really be stopped, and it's about time. And I think Manny Pacquiao says gusto niyang ipakulong ang mga magnanakaw.
All right. On that note, Mr. Lutz Barbo, thank you for joining me today.